Hello?
Please stop the left.
Is it okay now?
Yes, it's okay. Good.
Okay. Good morning from Greece. I will continue my lectures today, and the first part will be something between neutron stars and black holes, also an answer to the question that I got yesterday about superradiance and these kind of things. So yesterday we were discussing about the axial and polar perturbations for black holes. The same it is true also for neutron stars. If we get neutron stars which are not rotating, or relativistic stars in general, the equations become a little bit more involved. But if I start from the bottom of the page, for axial perturbations, if you look the equation that I have here, it is as similar as the case of black hole, but the only new thing is this term which is related to density and pressure. And actually, the axial perturbations for non-rotating stars, they do not induce density or pressure variations, and they only excite space-time perturbations, which are called W-mode. This is like the quasi-normal modes of black holes. On the top, I have the three equations that dictating the perturbations of the polar perturbations. The first two are wave equations related to the space-time perturbations, and the third one, this is H, stands for enthalpy, it is for the perturbations of the fluid. Of course, the system of equation is coupled. Outside the star, in principle, the third equation, we have no fluid outside the star, which is non-existent, and the other two equations can be combined, these two equations, to give us the Zerelli equation that we have seen already for the black hole perturbations. More or less in this case, in the exterior space-time, we get the black hole perturbations as it was before, and in the interior, things are changing a little bit due to the existence of the fluids. I will just discuss a little bit the last equation, the axial one, which is more or less very close to the black hole perturbations, which is the new term, is the one that I have shown you here. So this was subject of research by Chakrasekhar and Ferrari. This is copies from their original paper in 1991. And they have actually made an interesting observation that this potential here, this potential that we have here, when we plot it, yeah, when we saw, sorry for this thing, view, so slow, I cannot go into this yesterday's slides now, anyway. So, when we have seen this equation, we've done the plotting yesterday, with respect to R star coordinate, was like something looking like a Gaussian. But this is because we have the horizon and we manage in the R star coordinates to extend this potential from minus infinity to plus infinity. This is not the case when you have a star because you have finite, let's say, values towards the center. So this finite extension of the potential. And actually, near the center, the potential is somehow divergent, goes like 1 over R squared. So they say if we compactify, a normal neutron star, then this potential will change. And if the radius of the neutron star is inside, it is inside the potential barrier that we have seen yesterday, then you create a cavity here. And in this cavity, you can have, let's say, kind of bound state, or actually, to be honest, semi-bound states. And then this gives rise to perturbations of the space-time, But because these perturbations that are inside here, they cannot escape. I mean, independently, we have a strong perturbation. The signal, the perturbation has to penetrate the wave, the potential barrier. And if it is quite in the bottom of this potential well, it will take some time. So these perturbations do not dump very fast. They will remain there for some time. And of course, now it is, if I assume a rotating case, then these perturbations can be amplified from the rotation and become unsteady. This is more or less the equivalent of superadness. I will discuss this in the next slides. And for this exactly model, I have studied in more detail and I found exactly the structure of the spectrum as I can show you here. So you can see now the cursor is here. So this is the nice plotting, let's say, of the potential, how it looks like of an ultra compact body. And here is the spectrum. This is the real part, and this is the imaginary part, as we discussed yesterday for black holes. These dots in here corresponding to the quasi-normal modes of a black hole with similar mass like this neutron star here. While all the other modes, dots that you can find here, are related to the space-time perturbations of this ultra-compact neutron star. Some of them exist even if we don't have this ultra-compact star. For example, this part here and this part here with the interfaces, we call them curvature modes, all of them are W modes, are existing even for normal neutron stars. What is missing a normal neutron star is the trap modes, which are associated with this potential well that we have inside here. So this is the case now that they use it, one can use it, for example, assuming that you have a mirror on the horizon or something like this, then you block energy inside here, and then you can get, this was actually an idea by Press and Pekorsky, from 1982, they call it the black hole bomb. In this idea, they based all these hundreds of papers published in the last 2-3 years related to this type of instabilities. Of course, one has to find a good reason for having a potential barrier, I mean, inside here, to find that there's a divergent potential here, or that means that you have a mirror or something that in front of the horizon that reflects everything and does not absorb, or even partially. And there were ideas about gravastars, about wormholes, and all these kind of things that I will discuss in the next meeting. So actually at that time, I mean, just to see what it happens, look at this graph here. This here is the potential that we discussed before, and I send to this potential, and in green line, if you can see it here, a Gaussian pulse. As you can see, the Gaussian pulse enters, crosses the potential, some part is reflected back, and it looks identical to the quasi-normal modes of the black holes that we were discussing yesterday. But since you have trapped of energy inside this potential barrier here, you will see bits of let's say energy emitted subsequently, and the structure of these bits depends on how deep is the potential and the exact details of the potential and the model that you will use. On the right hand side, I have such an example. If you have, this is a kind of normal neutron star, you will see something which looks more like a W, like a quasi normal black hole. In the left, on the left side is an ultra compact star. You can see initially something which looks like the quasi normal of black hole, and subsequently you can see, let's say, bits coming out, and if you analyze them, you will see that they correspond to the frequencies, the characteristic frequencies or eigenstates of the energy states that we have seen that were blocked inside the potential well. So this is something actually, this simulation is from 95. I presented in a summer school in Les Eaux, and this data here. So this is, to be honest, more or less like a toy problem to see what strange things one can see in relativity. And then we just answer also this question that we discussed yesterday. That in these cases, you have what is called the, if you have rotation, you have more or less kind of creation of an ergoregion. And if you have an ergoregion, then it means that all types of perturbations are dragged to travel in the direction of rotation. So even if you send a signal backwards, it will be dragged to go forward. And this is actually the signal that is amplified that is responsible for this superradiant instabilities. And there is exactly the same thing in normal rotating neutron stars. You don't need to have these ultra compact stars. So we studied these problems, I mean, in 2004, and we have found that this is the case. But of course, always we should keep in mind that these stars should have, let's say, a radius of, or ultra, of 3-4 kilometers. Something that is not supported by, let's say, nuclear physics, or by observations that we have for neutron stars. And also the sound speeds that you expect for this ultra compact model to find in the center sometimes violate, let's say, the sound speed is louder than the speed of light. So there are physical constraints for not believing in these objects, and I consider them more or less like toy studies and not like real physics. Of course, there might be surprises, and this is why we study all these issues. Of course, these things became recently very exciting, and I will explain the reason. Just 2 years ago, we just returned to the problem with one of my students to find a complete analytic solution based on the WEKD approximations that I will discuss. I will discuss yesterday. So if you consider here, you have a problem with a potential barrier, the blue part, and the potential well. Can one find the characteristic frequencies? The answer is that we can, yes, we can solve the problem. This is what we proved here. And using the Bohr-Sommerfeld method that I have shown you yesterday, as a method for finding the quasi-normals of black hole, we can find also the quasi-normal modes of these ultra-compact objects. This was more or less like a technical paper, but at the same time that we published this thing, it came the detection, I mean, the detection of binary black hole mergers. And as you know, we have seen these kind of signals here. And we discussed yesterday, at the end of the signal, we have seen the ring down. Everything was seems perfect. But a year or so later, a group from Canada, led by Asfordi, suggested something that was not accepted by a local community, that they would see, after the initial signal and the quasi-normal ringing with some delay, some echoes coming out of the from the final object from that created from the merging of two black holes. And this is exactly the case that we were discussing before. So if this is true, if something like this really happens, a lot of people were not in agreement with what they suggested, then this means that we have not the creation of the horizon, or that we have at least a kind of barrier somewhere there that does not allow, let's say, to have a proper ingoing boundary condition at the horizon. And there is a way that something is reflected back, is trapped, as we have shown, inside here for some time, and then penetrates the potential barrier and comes out, and we see this kind of small, let's say, echoes here. And this generated a lot of excitement, and every, let's say, science fiction model has been used in order to explain these echoes. I'm not sure whether this is do or not, but we, because we have the techniques, we explore this case here. This is on the left, a graph that we produced in 2000 with Valeria Ferrari about these issues. On the right, we have done a study about the detectability of these things with LIGO, etc. But we are not the only ones. Other groups also done the same work. And then we try to see whether to solve the inverse problem. Okay, let's assume that you see the initial signal coming out and you see also the following echoes. The echoes will be dictated by the energy states that you have inside the potential well. And they will provide you information about the values of the frequencies related to these bound states here. And the question is if you can now, what you observe, this is observable, if you can reconstruct the potential. So we went to a procedure that you can find here in this list of papers. I mean, it's suggested by John Archibald Wheeler in 1976. I used it in the 90s for some other purposes. And now we could prove, actually, that for all these models, this model on the left is a model of an ultra-compact star, or a gamma star, or a star with a kind of mirror. The model on the right here is for the case of wormholes. So here we have a wormhole, so there is a cavity again, so you can have bouncing of energy between the two peaks on the both sides of the wormhole. And with the method that we propose here, you can reconstruct the potential. And look at the example here, this is the case of a constant density star. The exact potential is the black line, the reconstructed potential is the red line. You can hardly see the difference between the two potentials. So this means that if really something like this exists, then we can have an analytic or semi-analytic calculation of the geometry of the potential, and probably, we can see if this is science fiction, if you have, let's say, a barrier near the horizon, or you have a wormhole. This is the case about wormholes. You can see again the dark line, the black line, and the red line are identical when we do the reconstruction here. So this is even, we extended the method for normal neutron stars, and it works as well, and so on. But of course, all these things assume that you share the sensitivity in the detector to see not only the measure, the quasi normal drinking, but the rest of the signals, which will be an order of magnitude weaker than the initial, let's say, signals, at least. So it might not be something, because up to now I don't know if we have any really, when they will announce the new results, I don't think that there was any stronger signal than the first one that we get detected up to now. So this means that the chances to see something like this with a data that will release sooner or later are tiny. And probably it will be difficult, probably, unless we are lucky, to see something with a Virgo, LIGO, this generation. But something like this with Einstein telescope, or LISA, the space, or the Internet Explorer, Cosmic Explorer, will be feasible. Because there you will have a kind of much higher sensitivity, many more order of magnitude, more signals, and if you don't see anything, all these semi-science fiction scenario might not be valid and will be forgotten. And just something to remember that here there are four potentials. This potential here is the one we discussed yesterday for a black hole. This potential, the second on the top, is for ultra-compact star. The left on the bottom is for a normal neutron star, and this one with the two peaks is for wormholes. So if you study the spectra numerically with WGB, whatever way you like, you will find that the spectra they look somehow like this. The left one here is for the black hole. This is the fundamental mode that we observe here. and the spectrum goes like this and then up. This is for ultra-compact star. This is for the normal compact stars, and this is for wormholes. They look the same, but if you just be more careful on the y-axis here, you will see that the scales are different because the dump in time is different and depends on the compactness. The interesting thing is the following, that this black hole normal mode here, or quasi-normal mode fundamental, is very similar. You can find a very similar one in an ultra-compact star, or in a wormhole, or even in a normal star. So this means that with one, let's say, detection of quasi-normal mode, if especially the damping time is not calculated with good accuracy, it will be difficult, let's say, with just a quasi-normal mode, to say if it is black hole or something else which is ultra-compact. Just to keep this in mind. But if you have more than one mode observed, then of course things are becoming different. You cannot have agreement or accidental agreement between the two modes, because the spacing of the modes and the characteristics are different. So this is just to connect, let's say, more or less the black hole with the neutron stars. But today we will focus on the neutron stars and the gravitational waves. And I will start with some basic issues that neutron stars, we observe them everywhere. We didn't need gravitational waves to tell us about neutron stars. We know them as pulsars and X-ray binaries, ultramagnetized neutron stars called magnetars, binary neutron star systems. This was actually the first Nobel for gravitational waves for Tuchel and Taylor. And of course, recently we have seen the merger of neutron stars. The typical masses we know are about 1.2 to 2 solar masses, and the radius 9 to 15 kilometers. And even without gravitational waves, there was a lot of observation and many constraints set to neutron stars by observing the spectra, the electromagnetic spectra, because we can observe from their X-rays from thermonuclear, let's say, explosions on the surface of neutron stars during the accretion, burst oscillations. One can even calculate the cooling spectra of neutron stars, and from there we get the first indication of a superfluidity. There are kilohertz quasi-periodic oscillations of accretion disks around neutron stars. There is precessing binary neutron stars. All of them provide constraints on the parameters of neutron stars and even the question of state. And now we have the gravitational wave astronomy, which will provide us with more, let's say, independent somehow information. And the first thing is the tidal effects. As the two neutron stars merge, there is tidal excitation of frequencies, deformations, etc., which affect the signal. The tidal disruption, that you have black hole and neutron star mergers, the time that the disruption will start depends on the type of equation of state that you have, if it is soft or stiff. The oscillations of the stars, is a car, as we have in the case of black holes, they provide unique information about the parameters of the neutron star. And we have something like this before the merger, immediately after the merger, and if the star is surviving, also later in the merger. And I will discuss these issues as well. So what do we know? As you can see here, we have a kind of, here I can measure like 3,000, around 30, 35 equations of states. And this is a diagram, mass versus radius. So this is the allowed values for the mass and radius, at least from nuclear physics. The shaded areas up here are actually excluded due to causality. Now, we know by now that there are at least three cases, observations, that the maximum mass that reaches the two solar masses. So the equations of state, like the gray ones down here, which many of them come from quark stars, that they cannot give us models with two solar masses, are practically out of the gate. The other thing that we have to remember is that maybe the largest, the largest masses that we know for non-rotating neutron stars are two solar masses. But when you add rotation, you may have up to 20%, let's say, larger mass. So in the right diagram that we have here, this is the limit, upper limit here. In the diagram up here on the right, you can see, for example, this is one of these mass radius band relays, graphs that we have here. And if we just pick up this model and increase the rotation, then you can see that both the mass is increasing and also the radius is increasing. Actually, the equatorial radius, because there's a kind of flattening. So we expect, for example, the models that will get after the collapse, if they rotate very fast, or after the merger of two neutron stars, to accommodate much more mass. So let's say easily 2.4 solar masses, and especially if they have differential rotation, then they can accommodate considerably more. They can reach even 2.8, 2.9 solar masses. But of course, differential rotation ceases to exist after a few seconds or a few tenths of seconds. The star tends to be uniformly rotating, and if the mass is larger, let's say, than 2.5 solar masses, eventually will collapse to black hole. And this is what happens to one-third of the cases of the post-merger objects that we discussed yesterday and we will discuss again today. Now, the effort is to try to connect the properties of the neutron stars, the fundamental properties of neutron stars, find relations between them. So if I detect, if I manage to extract a piece of information, if this information can be used to extract further information. So for models of neutron stars, let's say when you construct a model of neutron stars, there are certain things that you can find, like what is the average density, what is the compactness of the object, what is the moment of inertia, what is the quadrupole moment, if you have a rotating star, or the tidal lap numbers, I mean the degree of deformability due to tidal interactions. These are quantities that every, let's say, open source code that constructs models of rotating neutron stars will provide. The question now is, are all these quantities independent from each other? The answer is not, and this is a very useful result. And this is some relations from Yagi and Yunus some years ago, in which they found that the moment of inertia and the Lamb number, for example, they have a very strong relation. This relation, the thick line, involves many equations of state, many models around this equation of state. On the right hand, we have another similar relation, that this is the quadrupole moment is a function of the Lamb number again, the degree of deformability. There's another strong relation about this. And this has been studied many, let's say, from different groups in different ways. There was also groups from here, the University of Athens, that cost me that they had done some feasible letters at that time strengthening this approximation. Now, so this has to do with stationary configurations which are not oscillating, they are not unstable, nothing at all. Now, if we assume that the star is vibrating, for example, if it is somehow unstable for some seconds, minutes, milliseconds, because when you have the creation of a proton neutron star, it will vibrate, let's say, wildly, and certain oscillation mode will be excited. In the stars we have, stars are much more complicated objects. We don't have a kind of no-hair theorem, as it is the case of black holes, that everything is described with two parameters, because the equation of state is a multi-parameter, let's say, includes many parameters. And so you can see oscillations which are related to the fluid, to the space-time, to the crust, to the magnetic field that may be present, and so on. And all these types of oscillations that I will discuss here, the oscillations like the F mode, which is the fundamental oscillation of a neutron star, of any fluid ball that you will set it into vibration. This is the fundamental mode of oscillation. And the frequency is more or less proportional to the average density or to the sound speed. The time that the perturbation will take, the period is roughly the time that will take the perturbation to go from one side of the star to the other and return back to you. So it will complete a full cycle. This is order of magnitude. The W mods is what we already have seen earlier. These are like the perturbations of the space-time, like the quasi-normal modes of black holes. They have the same, let's say, structure, and we suggested this with Bernard Schultz in the early 90s. The Alvin mods, I mean, these are due to the magnetic fields. We are not discussing them here, but they are extremely important because we have a class of neutron stars with extremely strong magnetic field, 10 to 15 and higher Gaussian called magnetars, and we have seen bursts from these magnetars, and these bursts, in this burst we can see, let's say, oscillations which can be associated with Alvin type of oscillations or magneto-fluid oscillations in the neutron star. And from there, we already set constraints to the equation of state and to the object that was emitting this X-ray signals. And finally, we have the inertial modes, which is a class of modes which are more or less the axial modes for non-rotating stars. I said they induce only space-time perturbations. But when the star is set into rotation, then we have also fluid oscillations, and these are the inertial modes, because the restoring force here is the Coriolis force. And the most known of these modes is what we call the R mode, because and this mode is actually generically unstable, and we'll discuss this stability later. So these modes can be associated with the parameters of neutron stars. I already discussed that the F mode, for example, is associated with the sound speed of the star and the average density. The inertial modes are of zero frequency in the absence of rotation, but then when they acquire a the star is rotating, the frequency is proportional to rotation. So when you see an R mode in a star, then more or less you know what's the rotation. The W modes are related with the compactness. We have seen already that depending on how compact was the star, there was the spectra was changing. The torsional modes that probably also are present, I mean, in all the neutron stars, and the magnetars, an explanation for the flares or hyperflares in magnetars is that you have cracks or cracking or breaking of the crust, and then you have here the magneto-fluid oscillations, but also the crust is vibrating. And these are the torsional oscillations. So these are also related to, I mean, they can be useful for extracting information for neutron stars. And in general, all type of modes give you some information, but the ones that I discussed, the first four, let's say, are related to potential observations. And we can associate them with observations, and they can be really useful. So in the mid-90s, working with Niels Andersen, then we have also a paper again with Harris Apostolalos, which is hosting me here at University of Athens. We have suggested that we can find strong relations between the frequency of the F mode, for example, and the average density, or the frequency of the W mode and the compactness. And actually, there is something very interesting here. This line here is the relation between the frequency and the compactness for normal neutron stars. The smaller line down here is the same relation, but for quark stars. So you can see, if you have a quark star, the W mode signal that you'll get is give you completely, will tell you immediately if you have a neutron star or a quark star. Can we see something like this yet? The answer is no. We will explain why, but it is coming. And maybe it is already in the data that because they have seen 7-8 mergers in the last year, they announced only one of them of neutron stars, so we see what's coming out. Just a quick passing by, because we won't have too much time, that these are neutron stars in the standard general relativity. But of course, if we have alternative theories of gravity, then there will the equations, dynamical equations, are a little bit different, and this will affect the mass radius relations. So you, by just using your favorite alternative theory for gravity, you can generate again mass radius relations. The most promising case somehow was the scalar tensor theory, but tends to die out somehow because the electromagnetic observations do not allow for, let's say, large deviation from GR. And so this means that if we have a non-rotating model, look at this graph here, this black line here, if you see the cursor, is for a static neutron star in Einstein's theory of gravity. The red and the green line here are is the case of constructing models of neutron stars in scalar tensor theory of gravity, and the zeta factor here that you see is related to the degree of the, is the, related to the coupling of the scalar field with the tensor field. As you can see, the deviations are tiny, so it will be difficult to see these effects for non-rotating neutron stars. We study the case of extremely fast rotating neutron stars. There, potentially, you can see deviations. These models here, the black line here, is the same, are the same stars that we have here, but pushed to rotate in the maximum with maximum rotation, what we call the Kepler limit. If the star rotates faster than this, the particles on the surface of the star will start escaping. It's more or less the escape velocity for particles on the surface. You can see, of course, here that there are deviations that potentially can be, potentially, I said, can be noticed. Similar things can be found, but again, for fast rotating stars, if one considers R squared gravity. We've done these calculations just a few years ago. And interestingly, the effects are more important if you study the moment of inertia for these objects. And actually, if you get do astroseismology as we've done before, you can see again nice strong relation between the frequency, and this is like the moment of inertia or the compactness of neutron stars. So you can tell from here, if you see the frequency, what is the compactness of the neutron star. I will not go into fine details here. Then we have the gravitational waves from collapse. Collapse was the, in the 60s or 70s or 80s, or when I entered into the field 30 plus years ago, was considering the most promising, let's say, source for gravitational waves. And even the bar detectors were tuned to the frequencies that would be emitted during the collapse. But of course, soon people realized that collapse will not give us a very strong signal and will be relevant only for events from our galaxy, or in the best case, from the nearby galaxies. So the signal we observe here is quite complicated, because you have the bounce on the core, and then you have the quasi-normal mode ringing if you have the creation of a black hole, or the oscillations of the central neutron star that is created. But still, in this case, I should say that things are difficult, and we need to have an event in our galaxy. The most promising scenario for the moment is the case of binary neutron star matrix. We know that we will, in the best, in the ideal case, we will see something like 15,000, let's say, pre-merger oscillations in our detectors for about 15 minutes when the stars enter into the window of the detector, around 10 Hz up to 1,000 Hz, where they will collide. Then you will have a phase where they merge, and then after that, we will have some oscillations. This is the post-merger ring down, which can be the ring down of a black hole. They can be the ring down of a supermassive neutron star, which you can see a few hundreds of oscillations, and then when the star stops being differential rotating will collapse the black hole, or they can last for much longer because the final object is not of the final mass is such that you can have a stable configuration. But in the already in the first part of the signal, whereas the two neutron stars approach each other, they start interacting tidally. And during this tidal interaction, you have this affects the signal, affects the phase. And the degree of tidal interaction depends on the equation of state. This is something that we have noticed already from 90s with Gerhard Seffer, and of course other groups also done similar studies. I mean, a paper that was 2 years ago by Paris and Sturanis repeats the same problem with many fine details. The idea is that as the two neutron stars approach each other, you may have resonant excitation of oscillations of the neutron stars. And these resonant excitations absorb the energy from the orbital energy, and this means that the binary will converge or they will merge faster. So in this graph on the right, for example, this line here shows how what is the distance till the merger and how much it will last the final stage if you have no tidal effects. If you have the tidal effects, things will be faster by whatever the units here, like 10, a kind of tenth of a second. But this is important because it changes the phase and it will be detected. Another thing that is also important is the tides, which are, let's say, the static tides. Because apart from the excitation of oscillations of the star, you can hear permanent deformations. And in this case, this affects the signal in the very last, let's say, orbits. Look at this very nice graph here produced by Jocelyn Green. If you see, if we go here, I mean, you see the sensitivities of the three detectors, the initial LIGO, the advanced LIGO rapid, were somewhere here. Now, if we have a merger of two black holes, then the line will be this black line here. So nothing happens, no tidal excitation or nothing else. It is just as, I mean, point partly more or less approximation predicts. But if we have neutron stars, when they approach each other, they are quite close. After, let's say, when the signal is between 500 hertz and 1,000 or 2,000 hertz, we have the tidal effects coming to the gain and deforming the signal. So these are deformations. And then, of course, we have the merger. And after the merger, we can see the oscillations in this reddish area is the after the merger part. In the first event that we observed in 2017, we could not see the merger part, but we could see the tidal effects. And these tidal effects can be modeled to provide constraints for the equation of state. And, yes. So I will come into this problem later. This slide more or less we discussed it yesterday, because as we predict, about 40% of the black hole mergers will lead to prompt, let's say, collapse of black holes. 30% will lead to a kind of long signal, but in the end will collapse down the black hole after some milliseconds or even seconds. And 30% of them will give you signals that will remain, I mean, the final system, the final neutron star that will be created will remain there forever. And in these signals, one can do now analysis. What frequencies are in this part of the signal or in this part or this part? Many groups, I mean, have done this analysis. And what you can see here in this analysis is that you see the excitation. Of course, you have an object more or less when the two objects are merging. Let's say, imagine that you have a kind of deformed object like this that is rotating. So you will see the emission of gravitational waves due to the rotation of a deformed object. But at the same time, you can see characteristic peaks. And this is like the F-mode quadrupole, let's say, deformation of the neutron star that will vibrate and will emit gravitational waves. And you can see this is from realistic LHC simulations, and you can identify various peaks here. This is a nearly axisymmetric oscillation. This is a quadrupole oscillation, and these peaks here correspond to coupling, non-linear coupling between these two modes. This is correspond to the difference of these two modes, and this peak corresponds to the sum of the two modes that we have here. So this means that there is a lot of information immediately after the merger. That, why? Because the frequencies, as I said before, we can associate them with the parameters of the neutron star. And in this way, we get, as we had before, the quasi-mode ringing of the black holes that was related to the parameters of the final black hole mass and angular momentum. Now we have the oscillations of the final object that will give you information about the mass, the radius, the spin, and the equation of state of the final object. And this is an effort that we undertook, let's say, to find out how to connect all these things together. So this just explains the various, what these frequencies correspond. So this oscillation thing of black holes, etc., initiated already 60 years ago, or less, by Chandrasekhar and Kip Thorne, and many of the students that, if you see all the names here, are famous relativists of our day. So, and this, initially they started working on non-rotating stars, either in GR or in post-Newtonian theory, as it was the case of Chandrasekhar mostly. Then they had to do, let's say, slowly rotating models, because the fast rotating models were difficult, as I will show you later. We discovered in this case, they discovered the instabilities of the rotational instability by Chandrasekhar, Friedman, and Schultz. We discovered the W modes that I mentioned earlier. It was the instability of the R modes was found. And all of these studies were either for non-rotating or slowly rotating stars. Still, the slowly rotating stars give us correct hints of how things should work. But the post-merger object is rotating near the Kepler limit, near the function rotation, because if you assume conservation of angular momentum of the two particles from the set that they emerge, when they emerge, this means that they rotate near to the Kepler limit. Might be even higher, and then they have to set the mass around the angular momentum so they can be stabilized. So this is more or less the history. And when we started these things, first of all, you have to construct configurations. Like in the non-rotating case, you assume more or less the, what is called the TOV equations. You assume a metric like this, and the energy momentum tensor, and then by solving the Einstein's equation and the conservation of energy and momentum equations, you can construct the models that we have shown before. So these are the models, these continuous lines. If, and these are the what is called the TOV equation, Tolman of a hyperbolic of equations. If now we add rotation, we add this blue term here, and we take into account the rotational effects, but up to first order. Up to first order means that we don't take into account the deformation due to the rotation of the object. So this is good for the neutron stars that rotate up to a few hundred Hertz. But this is not the case of the post-merger object, as I said before, which will be more than a kilohertz. And then, so this means that we have to study these models using the fast rotation. And then you have to construct models. This is the metric with four potentials, mu, psi, omega, and nu. And then you have to use the code like RNS or the, forget the name now, the RNS, the code created by Nick Sterioulas and John Friedman. And once you have this model, you would like to study oscillations. And again, you have to do what we have done earlier for black holes yesterday. So you assume small perturbations, you solve the perturbed Einstein and conservation equations, you assume decomposing to spherical harmonics as yesterday, and then you produce patterns like this. And when you solve this nice system of equations, that was the first slide that I have shown you, you can find the frequencies of the F modes, of the W modes, of all the modes that we discussed before. So this is what we have done up to the 90s for non-rotating stars, and using this system we derived the first astro-seismological, let's say, relations. When we have the rotation, things are becoming more complicated, because here we have the polar oscillations are decoupled from the axial oscillations. But once you induce rotation, they are not decoupled anymore, and the system becomes even more complicated. And so this is just a kind of graphical representation of the equations are huge. Let's say if you go to this Kojima paper 92, or my paper with Stavridis in 2004, you will see that the equations for this problem are a few pages. And so this was kind of not encouraging for study even in slow rotation of the stars. So most of the studies that we know are for non-rotating stars, and only a few for slowly rotating stars. So the fast rotating stars were more or less something like impossible. Impossible till kind of few months ago, that we published our first paper with one of my collaborators, and here we study really fast rotating stars. Why we need these stars? Because there are instabilities that can be good emitters of gravitational waves. And I will discuss these instabilities. I will just forget the dynamical instabilities. These are more or less do not apply for the equations of state that we know now, so let's don't discuss it more. But we have what is called the secular instabilities, and is the following idea. When you share a fast rotating neutron star, a model, let's say, with fast rotation, as we have seen yesterday in the case of black holes, rotations split the spectrum. So a certain mode will be split according if it is L equals 2, we have L equals 2, M equals 2, L equals 2, M equals 1, M equals 0, minus 1 and minus 2. Here I just saw that L equals 2, M equals 2, and L equals 2 and M minus 2. So you have a splitting of the modes, which in the case of black holes we have seen yesterday was not very large. But in the case of neutron stars can be large. So you have more or less perturbations, waves, let's say density waves, propagating on the star in the direction of rotation or going backwards. Those that go to the direction of rotation will just go, the frequency will increase with the rotation because they are dragged in the direction of rotation. While those that go backwards, as the star rotates faster, for an observer at infinity, will look as they have lower frequency. And it can be the case that the star rotates very fast, and in this case, for an observer at infinity, this, let's say, density wave that goes backwards, it looks for us, which are sitting far away at infinity, as if it is going forward. So this means that it has somehow negative frequencies here. These cases are the cases where the star is becoming unstable, secularly unstable, and this is what is called the Chandrasekhar-Friedmann-Schultz instability. What is happening here is more or less the following. Let me just skip this. I described it. We can see it again here. You share the mode that goes backward in the local, let's say, system. It has negative angular momentum. If we assume that the star has the positive angular momentum, the arrow of the momentum is going, let's say, you consider the positive, the direction of rotation. This goes backwards and has negative angular momentum. An observer at infinity will, if the star is not rotating, will see actually that this mode has really negative angular momentum. But as the star spins up, it will see that the star, this mode, is becoming less positive and eventually more or less it drags into the direction of rotation. It's not any more negative, but it's becoming positive. So this means that this mode emits gravitational waves for an observer at infinity with positive angular momentum. But actually, this density wave has negative angular momentum. So if you negative angular momentum and you lose an amount of positive angular momentum, then you become more negative. And this leads to an increase in the amplitude. This is more or less the essence of this stability. And what it happens again is, as we have the, I can say, the stability of the superaddits. Because what happens there, even if you send backward waves, they are forcing their inside algorithm to go forward. You send something backward, but it goes forward. The same thing is here, if you consider a kind of algorithm, but not with respect to the speed of light, but with respect to the speed of sound. So it's exactly the same phenomenon suggested also mathematically by John Friedman in the mid-70s. And this is something that we study here in detail. But these graphs that you see here are in what we call Pauling approximation. In order to do the calculations, because when you include fluid and space-time for fast rotating neutron stars, it is extremely hard. So we freeze the space-time and we evolve on a frozen, let's say, space-time of a rotating object, the fluid perturbations. So qualitatively it's a good study, but quantitatively it's not so good. I will discuss. And if you have this phenomenon, this kind of instabilities, then the stability, I mean, means that the amplitude will grow. And there are competing mechanisms, because you have viscosities present there and will try to suppress it. And you have viscosities like the shear viscosity, the star is cold, bulk viscosity, and so on. I have here some relations for those of you that are interested. And only if the growth time of this stability is faster than the damping time due to the viscosity, the stability will prevail and will be present. When we do the calculations for realistic neutron stars, it's not a trivial task. You can find out, for example, that there is a window that between the 10 to the 10 Kelvin and 10 to the 7 Kelvin, there is a window here where the stability can prevail and can grow in time. And for the R mode is this huge window here. For the F mode, I mean, if you have more structure in the neutron star, the magnetic field, type of viscosity, if you have dark matter, crust, etc., the window becomes a little bit smaller here, but it's always there. And the F mode, the other mode that we discussed, the stability is only when you have faster rotation here. There is also one part of the window, it is also cut out. So in 95, Lindblom and Mendel suggested that there is another type of viscosity mechanism, which is due to superfluid scattering of protons and neutrons there, and it's called mutual friction. But still, we have a clean window here for the stability to work. And I will, but of course, even if the stability works, you cannot work. This is a linear calculation. The stability will grow to an amplitude, cannot grow to infinite and destroy the star, because as it grows, you have coupling with other modes, as I described here. For example, this is the first equation. You describe the frequency or the oscillations, let's say, of an oscillator, which is in the case is applied for neutron stars, and which is becoming unstable. As it grows here, slowly, it reaches a maximum value and then couples with other modes and excites the other modes, so energy is leaked to other modes, and the other modes vibrate and heat up the star and so on. And in this way, you have a kind of saturation amplitude. You cannot go higher than this value. And this is very sensitive to the equation of state and to the type of mode that you start. We have done this calculation just to find what is, let's say, you should not expect too much, let's say, a highly deformed star, but still produces deformation that can allow detection of this instant unstable neutron stars from distances of megaparsec, as I will show you later. This is a kind of realistic situation. This is the instability window that I mentioned before. And imagine here at around nearly 10 to the 11 Kelvin, you may have a neutron star created after the collapse, rotating fast. Or the neutron star is created after the post, the merger of neutron stars. They get very hot and rotating very fast. So what it happens is really that as the star cools down, I mean, this is the frequency in logarithmic scale, and this is the rotation rate. T over W is the, more or less proportional to the rotation, is the kinetic energy over the gravitational energy here. This is a good representation of, for the rotating objects. You can see the object is moving, is cooling down and moving inward. But in a few seconds, the stability sets in. And this sets in, set the star in oscillations. And these oscillations heat up the star, so it cannot cool down farther here. And instead, it starts losing angular momentum through the emission of gravitational waves and follow this path up to this critical point. For this specific model, because this is supermassive, if you lose, let's say, if you rotate to 1.5 kilohertz and you drop down to 1 kilohertz, then the model is unstable, cannot sustain, the angular momentum cannot sustain, it is too massive, so it will collapse to black hole. So this is the, what I call here the black hole line. But during this time, a significant amount, more or less something like 40% of its angular momentum will be emitted in the form of gravitational waves. And this is a huge amount of energy, not compared to the binary neutron star merger energy, but it's a significant amount of energy that can be detected from some megaparsecs. I mean, this is the case also for neutron stars that we observe now that accrete matter and become the low-massive stray binaries, but I will skip this, that this can be present also in binary system, the low, what is called the low-mass X-ray binaries, where here we have the accretion, which spins up the neutron star, and as it spins it up, it becomes unstable. And as it becomes unstable, it emits gravitational waves and loses angular momentum, but because matter and angular momentum is continuously accreted, this will be more or less a process that can start last for years. And in this case, we might be able to study to find this kind of objects. For this reason, also the LIGO, for example, has the option for this object that was suggested, I mean, already 99, it's 20 years from now, they have the option for the narrow band. So you can just improve the sensitivity of the detector in a narrow band between, let's say, 400 and 700 Hz. So you dip down and you can check some of these sources. There are also many of these sources, but I won't, let me just skip it now because I'm going slowly and go back to these relations. So we have, I have shown you how nice are these relations for non-rotating stars that we produced 25 years ago. But as we said, rotation splits the spectra, so more or less dissolves these beautiful relations. So can we find, let's say, universal relations including the rotation? The answer is yes. We have done this problem with my student Eric Gerdick 10 years ago and we, for stars in the Pauling approximation. I mean, this graph here with proper normalization leads to this graph here. So this is, shows you how the frequency depends on the rotation and is independent of the equation of state and the model. So I can produce you, and the same also applies for the dummy. Look how nice looks the relation here. And we can produce nice relations which tells you how the frequency of a rotating, oscillating or a rotating star will rotate, link to the rotation here. So this is for modes that are going forward or backward and so on. So if we see some of these things, we can do the same thing as in the quasi-normal modes for black holes. And extract parameters. And I mean, we had various relations here. Let's the interesting is that these formulas are in what we call the Pauling approximation. So the space-time remains somehow still, so it was not vibrating together with the fluid. Qualitatively are correct, but quantitatively were wrong by 20-40% in the frequencies, because you more or less omitted the oscillation to the space-time, and 300% in the damping or time or the growth times. So we need to do these things properly in the full GR without any, let's say, slow rotation or freezing the space-time and all these things. And this is what we, I will skip this, I achieved with my collaborator Christian Kruger last year. So we assume, let's say, fast rotating stars, and we use kind of the Lorentz gauge. Not the previously, most of the studies have been done in the what is called the Regemuller gauge that we discussed yesterday, which we see that was not the proper one for this type of problems. But we instead we went to the Lorentz or Hilbert gauge that you know already from when you study, I mean, in flat space-time perturbed gravitational wave propagation, because here we have a clear term which is a wave operator. And so we have to solve, let's say, unfortunately, these gates does not eliminate variables easily, but at least you get pure wave equations. So you can evolve these wave equations, find the signal, extract the frequencies by Fourier transform. So when you do this thing, you get equations, I mean, you have to get, we get 10 equations for the space-time, and 10 and 4 for the fluid. So these equations are looking like this. Imagine the simplicity of the equations for black holes. And this is the reason that everyone is working for black holes, and quasi-normal modes of the black holes in every theory of gravity, because it's just a simple wave equation. And there are tens of ways to solve these equations. When you go into this problem, then you will face equations like this. And if you think that this is the equation, it's not. This is the case of treating the problem in the non-rotating case. If I add rotation, then this every of these equations, which are 4 or 5 lines, becomes about 30 lines. So you have 14 equations of this size that you have to write down correctly, study the stability of the problem and all these kind of things, and evolve them in time. And then, if you do this correctly, it took us nearly 2 years, you get a beautiful signal like this. Initially, you will see this thing here, which is like the quasi-normal modes of the black holes, which are the tumbling modes that I mentioned that we found with Bernstein in 92. And the rest signal is just fluid oscillations. When you now do the Fourier transform for this thing, you will find various peaks. This peak and this peak corresponds, this is the stable co-rotating mode, this is the unstable counter-rotating mode. This is the higher harmonics, the pressure modes, the W modes that we discuss here, somewhere here we see the R modes and the inertial modes. So everything is there. And it's the first time that something like this has been done, let's say, for neutron stars. We studied, okay, this is a, I mean, we studied about 300 models for 4 equations of state, and now we have results for 7 equations of state. So these models here, the red dots, correspond to models where you have a kind of you start with a model with the fixed baryon mass, and then you create a sequence of, I mean, you just construct models with the same baryon mass, but increase the rotation. Or you start with a model with the same central density and you increase rotation, these are the other bullets. So more or less it's a kind of mixed, you can see this model. But once you just find the frequencies, you can see that the scaling of the frequency is function of the T over W, more or less the rotation, or this line here, how nicely they are scaled, all these things. And I have some, yeah, this is another scaling that we, very useful for ultra-massive stars. I won't discuss it here. It is here to be seen, and so on. And in principle, this is something that is extremely useful, because these are all papers of the last year that try to connect the F-mode oscillations, let's say, with the properties of the pre-merger, post-merger phase, the collapse case, etc. And in all these cases, you need to have the correct frequencies or the correct formulas relating the frequencies with the parameters of neutron stars. So, if you give me two more minutes and I will finish. And I discussed the post-merger case, the violent phase, that you will have, let's say, end up in black hole sooner or later. But you may have also the case, one third of the case, you have a neutron star, massive neutron star rotating very fast, which is not exceeding the mass, the maximum mass limit, and will be there. But this star will rotate very fast. And of course, it may acquire quite strong magnetic field. So the question is, this star will be slowed down due to the light, as we see from the pulsars, because of the magnetic field. And the effect will be stronger if the magnetic field is larger. But what we propose, I mean, in 2015, and we further explore now, is that this star, because it rotates very fast, after a few seconds, it will become also unstable due to this Lasega-Friedman-Suzuki stability with the rotational stability. And if you think that this is science fiction, the answer is no. Because already, this is from 2013, there are more graphs here, but just to mention that we did not fix the results. These are results before the detection. This is the signal that we get from gamma ray bursts. In principle, you expect that this may come from the merger of two neutron stars. So you see an initial gamma ray burst up here, then you have, and then you have a kind of plateau here, which can last, this lasts 10,000 seconds actually, so a few hours, for example, or here is just only, also this plateau is about a few thousand seconds, or a few hundred seconds, and so on. So this means that the object survives for a few hours, maybe even longer, and is still active and emits, let's say, we observe it in the X-ray part of the spectrum. So if this gamma ray bursts are due to the merging of neutron stars, then there is a tail effect. And for some reason, the object, after a few hours, is collapsing down to the black hole, and the signal disappears. Sometimes it's characteristic when you observe seeing abrupt cutoffs. So it is not impossible that this happened due to the slowdown from the magnetic field, but also due to the slowdown or contribution, a combination of the instabilities of these F modes. The F modes become unstable, emit gravitational waves, force the neutron star to rotate slower, and in this way, eventually the star rotates slower, eventually it collapses down to black holes. This is part of our paper there, but we have, so the signal in this case, it will look like this, like inverse circle, if you like here. It will last hundreds to thousands of seconds, and it will be in the frequencies of a few hundred hertz, so it's favorable for the detector. You should remember that the star might rotate at 2 kilohertz, but this is not the rotational frequency, this is the gravitational wave signal frequency. So it is well into the sensitivity bandwidth of the detector. And here we show the strength of the signal. Somehow it says that if the magnetic field is the dipole component, because this is responsible for the slowdown, because we observed in the post-merger phases the kind of the growth of the magnetic field of the individual stars by a few orders of magnitude. But this is mainly goes to the toroidal component. And the toroidal component is not responsible for the slowdown, it's the colloidal component. And so if at least the magnetic field is up to 10 to 14 Gauss, then the main emission or the main slowdown will be due to the gravitational waves as we present here. And in this case, the signal will be detected, let's say, from 50 megaparsec. This is a calculation before we know the first measure of neutron stars, which was at 40 megaparsec. At 50 megaparsec, will be detectable with a signal to noise ratio of 4, let's say, with the advanced LIGO. If you remember 2 years ago when we had that detection, the LIGO was in a kind of 30% of the peak sensitivity. So we have not seen the merger phase and the post-merger phase. But eventually something like this at 40, 50 megaparsec will give you a signal, probably an afterglow signal. This is how we name it in the paper, after the merger, a few seconds after the merger. And of course, if we have the Einstein telescope, because the sensitivity will be improved by a factor of 10, you can see events like this, not from 50 megaparsec, but a few hundred megaparsec. And already we have seen now 6-7 such events at 100-150 megaparsec the last year. Of course, we don't expect with the present sensitivity something like this to happen, but with Einstein telescope, these kind of events will reveal, let's say, the afterglow and if there is a gravitational wave signal after the merger. And this signal will be extremely important because will tell us, I mean, because we observe oscillations, and as we said before, we can see what finally the final object, what is about. This star is now called supermassive neutron star. What is the rotation? What is the mass? What is the radius? And probably what is the equation of state? So this is an extra verification of what we know. Let's say what we will know about the neutron stars from the pre-merger information, early post-merger information, and so on. Concluding, the oscillations of neutron stars are extremely important in the era of gravitational waves. We might not be able to see something in the next few years, but is actually in all the proposals for the, if you read the proposals for the Einstein telescope, one of the key issues is the equation of state of neutron stars via this type of oscillations. So this is a kind of hot field of research now, which the results will be applied, I mean, if not tomorrow, but in 2-3 years from now on. This is from me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your good lectures. Is questions?
Yeah.
This is Gung Wan again. Your talk was very, very interesting and covers many topics. But I would like to see how you identified the spectrums for the fast rotating case. So would you show the slide about the spectrum F mode and other things?
Yeah, I can tell you. Yeah, okay. I mean, there are things like, so this is the slide that we're discussing, so that I go to the slide, okay, here, then we'll go here. Okay, yeah. Because we can extract the eigenfunction. I can tell you, I mean, I can show you in the data how we do it. We start with an orthodontic star, and we track the frequency, which is easier for the orthodontic star, and then we increase the rotation. So to reach to this model, they were, let's say, from the going to 90% of whatever is the maximum rotation, we have already 10 models starting from slow rotation, and we see how the spectrum evolves. At every stage, we can extract the eigenfunctions. And then every type of mode has characteristic eigenfunction, as you know. So this is how we can tell what type of mode is each one of them. If you ask me now, you just show me a graph like this. Now, with the experience that I have, I can tell you directly what every peak it is. But this is not, of course, the case. I mean, we just studied properly and systematically.
Another short question is, in the case of a rotating star, the equilibrium configuration has this theta dependence. So the decomposition of the angular part is not possible with just spherical harmonics or things.
So, in the case of rotating star, you said what is happening. So, because my sound is not very good.
Okay. In the perturbation equations, we can use this decomposition for the angular part, theta and phi. Yes. But in the rapidly rotating case of stars, there is no. It's not possible to use such spherical harmonics.
Yeah, we don't use spherical harmonics.
Yeah.
We only use this decomposition here.
Only the actual angle decomposition. Okay.
Exactly. This is the phi decomposition. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Because then, if you see these equations, practically the wave operator is time, r, and theta here.
Okay.
So we have a 2 plus 1, let's say, dimension evolution, not 1 plus 1.
Okay. So you just simply solved this numerically as a function of time and obtained
yes.
the form and then Fourier transform to identify the spectrums.
Exactly.
Okay.
Because it's not possible to solve it as a proper boundary value problem. It's very difficult or impossible to get, let's say, correct or good boundary conditions and infinity. It's not like the Kerr problem. Because the Kerr is not Kerr for a rotating star.
Ah, I see.
So we cannot use, let's say, for non-rotating stars, the Kerr is Schwarzschild. We can use the typical Schwarzschild, let's say, boundary conditions and infinity for the equation gives you. Here we don't have something like this, so it is. This is the only way to do the problem.
Are you sure that that's the only way, or there is some other way?
I'm sure this is the only way that I can do it, but I know that more mathematical persons than me in the early 2000, I mean, there were some serious colleagues that tried to get boundary conditions at infinity for proper boundary conditions for the perturbation problem at infinity, uh-huh. and they failed. It's not me. So this is what I can tell. For me, it was already from the beginning, I said I cannot solve this problem, let's try to find an alternative way. Because actually we use this kind of way even for the non-rotating stars, just to test how things have worked. Already 20 years we had our first paper about this. And this was for me the most, let's say, the viable way to solve the problem.
All right, thank you very much.
So Questions?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. In terms of the detectability of the gravitational wave, damping mechanism of the wall.
Sorry, let me, because yes.
Okay.
Yes, please repeat the question because the sound on my side is not very good.
Okay, so in terms of the detectability of the gravitational wave, the damping mechanism of the each mode is very important. So do you have any idea about that? So what is the most significant damping mechanism in the neutron star?
Sorry, I couldn't understand the question. The sound is not very good. I don't know what I can do about this. Closer to the microphone, if possible.
So, what is the most significant damping mechanism of the each mode of the neutron star?
What is the most significant
damping mechanism?
such as the viscosity or gravitational wave?
Yeah. In principle, let's say the damping, as we assume here, is due to gravitational waves. But of course, and for many of these modes, let's say, in the regime, if the star is hotter than 10 to the 7 Kelvin, I mean, the viscosity is not so important. So there is the window that I said, independent if it is the stability or not. For example, if you just calculate in a typical, an old neutron star, for example, the damping due to the viscosity compared to the damping due to the gravitational waves, the gravitational waves are more important. There are calculations for non-rotating, forget the other things. I mean, if it is very cold, or if you assume that you have an extra cast or the mutual friction, then you may have more, I mean, most of the perturbation will be dumped through this mechanism. But when I show you the windows that we study, which are quite realistic, if I go back to this slides here. Yeah, something like a slide like this here. This is a quite realistic window because we expect, let's say, the stars to be dynamically. This is about 10 to the 10 Kelvin here. So 10 to the 10 Kelvin is the temperature immediately after the first millisecond after the merger or after the collapse. And these are the objects that we're interested. So on the right, the bulk viscosity kills any oscillation, but on the left, inside here, the star is becoming unstable. And there is a lot of time till the cooling down from 10 to the 10 up to the 10 to the 7 Kelvin. So for this, inside this window, even if it is not unstable, the star, the gravitational wave damping is prevailing over the viscosity, fluid viscosity mechanism. This is the point. Even if we consider the superfluidity that I have shown you here, still we have this wide window here.
Costas, we cannot see your slide.
Sorry. I could see them. I have to press this start. Sorry. Now you can see. Okay. Can you see the slides now?
You can see the...
Not yet.
Your slide is behind the video picture.
Yes. Start. So now, and then we go to this. Can you see it now?
You need to hide the screen.
So what do you see?
Hide
you
the video.
Video. We only can see the video screen.
The slide is on the bottom of your video panel.
Now we can see.
Stop sharing. Share screen. Start sharing. Now you can see yourselves. And then we go here and we can see in principle. Can you see now my screen?
We only can see. Now we can see.
Okay. So this is what I said, that if we go into this window, rotation versus temperature, the viscosity, the shear viscosity as damping mechanism becomes really important below the 10 to the 7 Hz. So you need an old neutron star that already has crust and all these things. On the right hand side, we have the bulk viscosity, and here the star more or less enters. The neutron star is created, or the very first milliseconds, it is over 10 to the 10 Kelvin. But very soon, the temperature is below 10 to the 10, and then again, the bulk viscosity cannot damp the oscillations. And so you have this window between 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 10, that really the main damping mechanism is the gravitational wave damping, due to gravitational waves. And of course, even if the star cools down to 10 to the 9 Kelvin, which may happen after a few minutes or hours, because then you have the superfluidity in the pore of the universe star. What we have found by doing the simulation, let's say solving the balance of heating up due to the oscillations of the fluid, etc., we found that the star never leaves this white region here. And why? Because if we go into this graph here, the star initially cools down. But at the same time, we have, for example, this stability heating up the star. And as it heats up, it comes into equilibrium configuration. This is simulation. I mean, I draw them by hand, but I can show you the exact graph from the simulation. And as it moves inside this window, at temperatures just below the 10 to the 10 Kelvin, for up to, slowing down considerably to collapse to black hole or whatever else. So there is plenty of space for newly born neutron stars to oscillate, develop instabilities, and so on, without really being afraid of the viscosities due to fluid properties. I answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. So, any other questions? I have a question. You said about wormholes in the middle of your talks, right?
Yes.
So, then, is it possible to discriminate a wormhole from other stars by using gravitational waves?
Yeah, the worm in the beginning that it was somewhere. Here, somewhere here, when we're discussing these things here. This one. Is this what we were asking?
Yes. That's right.
Yes, it is true. It is possible because the spectra are somehow different. I mean, for example, if I show you this graph, if it is this an ultra compact star, okay. Then, if I send a Gaussian from the right to the left, the Gaussian will be reflected on the barrier, and one part will be reflected, and one part will enter into the cavity here. The part that will be reflected will look like the quasi-normal mode of a black hole. Does not care what happens after the barrier. And this is the case also for the wormhole, because it's the same barrier here as it is on the left and on the right. So if you shift this barrier here with a gravitational wave coming from plus infinity, it will be reflected and transmitted. So this first burst that will come out will not tell you if it is black hole, neutron star, if you like, or wormhole. But then the part that will will penetrate and enter into this cavity here. First of all, if it is a black hole, this boundary is not there, you will see nothing coming out. So this is black hole. If it is an ultra compact object like this on the left here, you will see coming frequencies out on a specific, let's say, spacing. And if it is a wormhole, it will see another set of frequencies. Of course, some of the frequencies might look similar, but the spacing is not exactly the same. And also the delay time that, for example, they need to hit the other barrier and come back. Imagine here, if I have a pulse or a particle penetrating, comes here, hits and comes back. And here, going into the other barrier, coming back. So there are hints that you can, we calculated the frequencies in these papers with my student Sebastian Volker. If someone is interested, if you can look at these papers, you can see even the tables of the frequencies, etc. So you can tell really that this is this object or the other object. And this is the way that we can reconstruct from the frequencies the potential. This potential, we got the frequencies from a constant star, we put them down and we reconstructed this potential. if it was a black hole, we reconstructed a wormhole, we reconstructed a wormhole. So there are all these options. Or even if you have, for example, in a wormhole case, the interior barrier might be lower, just an example. So you can have partial penetration and partial reflection. And so we study also this, all, everything will be imprinted in the spectrum. Of course, it might be something that we didn't get to imagine how it is, but with this inversion technique that I suggested here, because this is an agnostic one, you try to construct, you don't know anything about the potential, you know only the spectrum. And you try to, and I describe it somewhere here, yeah, this inversion technique, then you try to see what is the potential. So you will find the potential, and then it's up to you, your physical intuition, to guess what type of, let's say, object we have over there.
Okay, thank you very much.
Great intuitions. As you explained, we can distinguish two cases, but I also wonder how strong the signals are, because the ultra-compact case will be anyway the almost late stage of some very dynamical phenomena. And warmer case, can you expect some kind of dynamical phenomena leaving this warmer state finally?
Yeah, first of all, I should say that honestly, I don't believe in echoes. Although I get all these works, it's because we had the technology, let's say, to get these results in case that 1 per 100%, let's say 1 per 1,000, there is something like this, that this is how should people work on this. Secondly, let's assume that they exist. The signal will be much weaker. And so I said that potentially with the LIGO we cannot say much unless we are lucky. But I think that the LISA and Einstein telescope will set some lower limits under which these echoes will not be important. Okay, if I answer to this thing, I mean. And also the wormhole models that we use are just, I mean, there are many models of wormholes, as you know, I mean. We just took a specific model, this Solotuit in the more type of model for the wormhole. In principle, let's say if we get all these frequencies, we see all these echoes, and we reconstruct the potential, this might guide us somehow to what type of wormhole is there. But as I guess you said something, if I understood, I mean, it will take some time from wormholes the signal to come out. It's not a reflection that could be immediately coming out. So it's, I don't know. I mean, I said we have done this calculation. I saw this calculation. This is how one should study, and these are the tools that one should use. But maybe I'm too conservative. I'm skeptical about all this effort. This. I don't know if I answer your concerns or not.
Yeah, you answered. Yeah, you answered. I have a similar feeling about those cases. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions? Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your good, interesting talks. Let's thank the speaker.
Where's your step? How I can see you? I should thank you. Can you see me now?
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your attendance, and I'm really sorry that I missed the opportunity to come to Korea. I was planning for a long time to do this trip, but it didn't work. Hope another time that I will have the chance to come. Okay. Thank you. Good. I hope. I wish you good continuation of the school, and we may have the chance another time to be meet from close. Okay.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
We may have another chance.
And also, if someone has more questions, I mean, from the audience, you can write me privately an email, and of course I will answer the email. Because if you think of things that you, it was not clear when you're looking back to the, my slides. Okay.
Will you send the slides?
Yeah, I sent the slides already. Yes,
okay.
The slides are, I sent it to...
Okay.
Yeah, the
slides
there. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, let's finish.
Okay.
Thank you very much. So, is there an announcement?
Yeah, the banquet is going to be upstairs on the third floor at 6:30.